Okay. So, you remember the form of the Hamiltonian for the free particle? Just let's recall the normal Hamiltonian, okay, for a free particle. E square by 2m, right? Kinetic energy plus some potential energy, right? This is the general simplest expression for a particle. Now, in our case, what happens? Our Hamiltonian becomes P minus QA by C square by 2m plus, plus Q phi. Right? So this was the form of the Hamiltonian that I had derived, I guess, in the last to last class. Yeah, okay. So yeah, this is the Hamiltonian. Right? And now, what is the important point to notice here is that this momentum P, right, I'm writing as capital P, it's actually the canonical momentum, right? It's not the mechanical momentum. So the mechanical momentum is gamma mv. In general, it's gamma mv. Otherwise, you know, in the non-relativistic limit, it's just mv. And this kinetic term, actually, this kinetic term, so the relationship between small p and capital P, what is the relationship? This capital P is equal to small p plus QA by C. Right? This is what you get if you do the variation of the action of the Lagrangian, right? You get this when you take the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the particle velocity, right? So this tells us that small p is equal to p minus qa by c. So now if you look at this expression, right, what is this expression? This expression is actually exactly the same as this expression, right? Because capital P minus QA by C is the small p. Right? So you might ask, well, then what's the point of writing it in this way? Like, I mean, isn't the electromagnetic field doing anything? So the answer to that is the fact that there are two different things. One is that, well, if you're talking about like Hamiltonian mechanics, right? So in Hamiltonian mechanics, you have a phase space, right, for your system, and your phase space consists of some coordinates and some momenta, right? And then these coordinates and momenta are related to each other. Their evolution is given by the Hamiltonian, by Hamilton's equations, right? So xi dot is dh by dpi, and pi dot is equal to minus dh by dxi, right? If the any of the equations are too small, let me know. I'll scale them up. Okay. So if you want to correctly describe the system, the dynamics of the system, right, you have to use the phase space variables which are conjugate to each other, right? And on the phase space, what can you do? You can define a structure which is known as a Poisson bracket, right? Right. So if I have any function on the phase space, so that means f is a function of my coordinates and my momenta, and I have another function which is on the phase space, right? Then there exists this operation which is called the Poisson bracket, right? Between these two functions, so here the curly brackets denote the Poisson bracket operation. And what is this given by? This is given by df by dxi dj by dpi. Right? Have you all seen this description before? My hope is that you have seen it in classical mechanics. If not, well, no. Well, there's always a first time for everything. So if you just take your so in particular, if you just take your function f to be xk for some k, right? You just take your function to be one of the coordinates, okay, for instance, and you take g to be another coordinate, right? Then what will you find? You will find that xk xl is equal to zero, right? The Poisson bracket between any two position variables. So here x and p, x is a 3 vector and p is a 3 vector, right? So we are talking about the Hamiltonian formalism, right? So in Hamiltonian formalism, you separate space from time, right? So the Hamiltonian is not a covariant object, okay? So if you're talking about a Lagrangian, then x and p would be like could be 4 vectors. But in this case, what we do is we pick out a preferred sense of time, right? Because if you have a if you look at Hamilton's equations, for instance, right, these equations, the dot here represents a time derivative, right? So there is, that means there is some observer with respect to whom this system is evolving, right? So when we write down the Hamiltonian, we are saying that, well, this is what the Hamiltonian is with respect to the observer in the lab, let's say, okay? And so x and p are this thing, 3 vectors, okay? So coming back to this Poisson bracket structure, the Poisson bracket between position variables is zero, the Poisson bracket between momentum variables is zero, and if you take the Poisson bracket between one position and one momentum variable, what do you get? Anybody?
Delta function.
You get a delta KL. Right? And what is the main So this is basically the structure of a mechanical system, right? In the Hamiltonian picture, you have a phase space, you have a Poisson bracket, you have the Hamilton's evolution equations, right? And then what makes the Poisson bracket so special is that under canonical transformations, right? So you can transform from your given set of variables. So okay, let me not use curly braces because to some other set, let's say capital X, capital P, right? You can make a transformation where the new momenta are functions of the old momenta and positions, and the new positions are also functions. So this transformation is a canonical transformation if and only if the Poisson bracket is preserved, right? That means these relations which hold for the old phase space coordinates should continue to hold for the new phase space coordinates. Anyway, so this is the framework. So the point of all of this is that when I apply this framework to my system, which consists of a point particle coupled to an electromagnetic field, then my canonical momenta is given by this object, which is my mechanical momentum plus QA by C. So if I talk about the time evolution of the position of the particle, for instance, I have to take the derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to this quantity. And similarly, when I talk about the time evolution of the momentum, that is P dot, which P should I evolve? Not the mechanical P. I have to use the canonical P. So when I say P dot in Hamilton's equations, which P is that? That's capital P. And so when I take P dot, it becomes a sum of small p dot plus there is an extra term coming from the vector potential A, right? Mm-hmm. There'll be an A dot term also there, right? That A dot term, you'll get dA by dt. And that will correspond to your electric field, right?
Okay.
So the point is, I hope this is clear that why it is used in this way. Okay, this is one reason. Then the second reason is to do with quantum mechanics. Okay, so now in quantum mechanics, what is the main utility of this Hamiltonian picture, right? I mean, why do we care about the Hamiltonian picture? Why can't we just use Newton's equations, F is equal to d2x by dt squared? Why do we need to do all this, like phase space and all that? Well, the reason it's so useful is because it allows us, it gives us a prescription to take a classical system and convert it into a quantum system, right? What is that prescription? The prescription is that you take your phase space, and now your coordinates and your momenta become operators. Right, so you have a state space, you have some Hilbert space, which is your set of states, and these operators, they act on states, right? And what property do these operators satisfy? They satisfy a commutation relationship, which is what? IH bar, right? So in the classical case, we have the Poisson bracket, and in the quantum case, we have the commutator, right?
Yes.
And what happens? The on the right hand side in the classical case, we have a real number, and it becomes a this complex number, and this H bar is there, right? So you might ask, well, what is H bar doing? So H bar tells you the size of the quantum effect, right? So when you want to go from a classical, when you want to take a quantum system and look at its classical limit, what do you do? Like one way to do that is to consider the case when H bar goes to zero, right? So when H bar goes to zero, there are no more quantum effects. So you can think of this H bar as measuring the quantumness of the system, right? How quantum is it? So anyways, so when we want to write down the quantum mechanics for a Hamiltonian, for a particle, free particle coupled to an electromagnetic field, in that case, our Hamiltonian becomes an operator, right? Mm-hmm. And now this operator is given by an expression of this form, right? Now here, note one thing. I have put a hat on top of the P, but not on top of the A. Okay. Why is that? Because here what I'm saying is that my particle is quantum. Okay. So I have a quantum mechanical particle that is interacting with a classical electromagnetic field. Right? So I'm not making my electromagnetic field also quantum. And I don't want to do that at that point, because as we know, you know, from hindsight, that if you make the electromagnetic field quantum, then you have to introduce something known as quantum electrodynamics. You have to introduce photons and Feynman diagrams, and the world becomes endlessly more complex. Okay. So in the limit, so there is a certain limit. There's some background noise, I think, maybe coming from your side, Manas. Okay. So Hira, you're following? You have any questions, you please ask me, huh? Amrita. Yes, see, that's why it's good to have the video feed on, because I can look at your expressions and I can get an idea of you know, how, like, whether you're feeling comfortable with the material or not. Right, Amrita? Amrita, you're sitting out in the balcony of your house?
No, sir.
No? Where is it? Isn't... Unmute. Okay, never mind. Amrita, you have to unmute yourself, na? I think you muted it. Anyway, fine. She doesn't want to tell me about where she's sitting. Fine. Right? So, so here we are considering the limit where we are not worried about the quantum fluctuations of the electromagnetic field. And also, of course, keep in mind that the electromagnetic field here is a static field. We are not talking about Maxwell's equation. So we have a particle, quantum particle interacting with a static classical electromagnetic field. Okay, so this is the prescription, right? The prescription is that if you want to go from the classical picture to the quantum picture, what do? You put a hat on everything, right? And in other words, you make everything into an operator. So when you are in the, now in quantum mechanics, you know, there are two representations. Actually, there are an infinite number of representations, but there are two that you deal with. No? One is the position representation, one is the momentum representation. One is the Fourier transform of the other. So in the position representation, what happens? If I take my, in the position representation, my states are functions of my coordinates, right? And my position operator, when it acts on this state, it just gives me, it just gives me the position as my eigenvalue. Okay, and my momentum operator acting on this state, what is it? Minus I h bar, right? And then d by dx psi of x. Right? This is the prescription for writing down the operator version of a momentum, right? And, but of course, you can write the same state in the momentum representation also as functions of the momenta. So in that case, the roles become reversed. Once again. Right, so the roles become reversed. So here, now if I take x, okay, what is this? One second, my, I was too cheap to afford an iPad and an Apple Pencil, so I went for the Android version. And they are not as smooth, though they are good enough. So anyways, when you act on a momentum state, momentum eigenstate with a position operator, what do you think will be the result? I think it will be IH bar d by dp, right? It's a derivative, but with respect to the momentum. And P acting on this will just give me the momentum, because these are by definition momentum against. Okay. So now, if I want to do apply this prescription to my Hamiltonian, right, then I have to take my momentum operator. Which momentum operator? The canonical momentum operator. Not the mechanical one, it is the canonical one. So here, all of these momenta, these are the canonical momenta and canonical position, which are being replaced by the operator versions. So if I want to write down the quantum mechanics of that system, then I cannot take the classical momentum gamma mv, right? And replace that with an operator, which is this gradient, right? I can't do this. This is not allowed. Why? Because P is not canonical. Right? So if P is not canonical, then what will happen in the quantum theory? You remember I have this commutator relationship. X and P is equal to I H bar, right? This relationship will not be preserved, right? This relationship will not be true if I use the mechanical momentum. This relationship will be true only if I use the operator which corresponds to the canonical moment. Okay. So it's the canonical momentum that I have to use. And therefore, I cannot do this to go to the quantum theory. Instead, what do? I have my canonical momentum. This canonical momentum gets transformed into an operator. And what is the form of that operator? Well, this quantity. So what is the form of this operator? This operator becomes minus I H bar gradient. Right? This is the right prescription. Now, if I take this expression and put it into the Hamiltonian to get the Hamiltonian operator, what will happen? I have the Hamiltonian here. Here, now I will replace my momentum with the momentum operator, which is minus I H bar gradient with respect to X. Right? So what will be my Hamiltonian? Operator will be minus I H bar gradient, then minus Q A by C squared by 2m plus E phi, whatever my Tejasri. Hi Tejasri, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Ah, okay, good. Good to know that you are there. Thanks for coming, by the way. Otherwise it will be a flop show. Okay, so this is the correct Hamiltonian operator for a quantum particle interacting with a classical static electromagnetic field. Okay. So I hope that this line of reasoning is fairly clear. Because you have to like understand some of the basics of classical mechanics and quantum mechanics to be able to follow this. But I think all of you have covered that, I think, in sufficient detail in many different points. And what you have not covered, I hope that whatever you might have not covered, I hope those gaps I am able to fill in I find that many of my classes actually end up being more like remedial tutoring sessions, where I have to cover a lot of basic material which sometimes gets left out from the other class, other sections, other courses. Right. So this is the procedure. You start with the Hamiltonian, you replace your momentum operator with your gradient, and then you write down this Hamiltonian. So if you want to write down, for instance, if you want to talk about an electron in a hydrogen atom, right? In that case, what would be the picture? What would be the potential energy of the electron? Phi of x would be, what is the potential energy of an electron in a hydrogen atom? Anybody?
Coulombic force. Coulombic.
Minus Ke by, right. By R. Right? Mm-hmm. So this would be your function which goes in the potential term. So you get minus Ke square by R. Okay. Now, this prescription also, we can do some more algebraic manipulation and something else, something interesting. One more interesting point can be noted for those of you who might be interested. Maybe not all of you, but I think some of you will definitely find this interesting. Is that if I look at the kinetic term, so if I just look at the kinetic term of the Hamiltonian operator, and I take out this factor of minus IH bar from the brackets, so I get minus IH bar squared, minus IH bar squared, I take that out by 2m, then inside the bracket I'm left with gradient, and then here I get Q divided by IH bar A by C whole square, right? Because I take this minus IH bar, I'm pulling it out, so I get IH bar down here and a plus sign here, and this can be written as minus IH bar squared by 2m del minus Q IQ by H bar A by C whole square, right? So the interesting thing to notice is that this whole expression can be written in this way, minus IH bar, and then this new symbol I've used, this curly D, okay, capital D, curly D whole square by 2m. And what is this curly D? This curly D is my normal gradient, I'll put a vector, just minus IQ A by C H bar. Okay. So we'll put a box because this is also. So now for those of you who took general relativity, this object is our covariant derivative. Right? So the presence of a vector potential causes your derivative operator to change in this way. So this whole thing can be written, you know, as a momentum squared or a derivative squared, and that, but that derivative is this oxide. Okay. Are there any questions?
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, how this is a covariant derivative?
That's a good question. I'll address that maybe not in this class, maybe in the next class. Okay. It involves a little bit more explanation.
Okay.
Yeah. But it looks like a, you know, you have seen this before, right? That your covariant derivative, or you know, looks like your normal partial derivative plus some
Christoffel symbol is there.
So yeah. In this case, you have a vector this thing, vector field.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, so what Akshay asked, this is an important question, and we'll come back to it later. Okay, I have to address this eventually. Why is this a covariant derivative? We'll talk about this. Anyway, I just mentioned this out of as a curiosity for some of you who are interested in such things. So I don't want to go too deep into this also. Okay. Now, let's ask ourselves, what happens if I take this Hamiltonian, right? And I expand this square term. So the square term, let me write it out again, is minus IH bar gradient, what is it, minus QA by C, whole square by 2m. And you have to remember that this whole thing is an operator, right? That means this will act on some state psi, and it will give me some other state phi. Okay. So when I square this out, what should I do? What is the square of the first term? The square of the first term will be minus plus, it will give me minus h bar square del square, right? Minus h bar square del square by 2m. That's from the square of the first term. The square of the second term will give me q square by 2mc square. And this vector field will just become A square, right? It will become A dot A. And A is not an operator, so I don't have to worry too much about that. But the next two terms are the more interesting ones. So the next term will be the cross term. The first cross term will be del times A, and the other cross term will be A times del. Okay, so how should you understand these two terms? So let's look at the three factors. I'll get I h bar q by 2m with a plus sign. So I h bar q by 2m. For both of those terms, I'll get the same prefactor. The one of the terms will be the gradient dotted with A, and the other term will be the A dotted with the gradient. Okay, so again, you should think of this, this is an operator, right? So it's acting on something, it's acting on some state. So that's how you should view these terms. Del dot A, what does it actually mean? It means that I have some state psi, and first A acts on that state. Well, what does it mean for A to act on that state? A is just a, it's just a bunch of numbers. So it will just multiply the state. And then del will act on this combination. So I will get two components. One will be divergence of A multiplied by psi, and the other will be
A
multiplied by A or A dotted with the gradient of psi. Right? Now, we have this term here, del dot A, divergence of A. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so here, del dot A, what is, this is, now this is not an operator, now this is just del dot A, like it's a divergence of a vector field. And if you remember, we can use the freedom of gauge transformations, right? We have this gauge freedom. According to that gauge freedom, I can take my vector field and replace it by another vector field by adding the gradient of some function chi. But then I have to take my scalar potential and I have to replace that also with the time derivative of this chi, right? So if I make a certain choice of chi, so I have this freedom, right? So that means A and phi are not uniquely determined. So if I want to uniquely determine them, one of the things I can do is I can impose this restriction that divergence of A is zero, right? So if I impose the restriction that divergence of A is zero, so let's say I start out with an original, my original field is A. If I take the divergence of this field, I don't get zero, okay? So what do? I perform a gauge transformation. I write down A prime. This is my transformed vector potential. And then I ask, then I impose this requirement that del dot A prime has to be equal to zero. So what will that give me? Del dot A prime is equal to del dot A plus del square chi. Right? And this whole thing is zero. So,
sir, one this, doubt.
One second. So this gives me a differential equation for chi. One second. Yeah, tell me. What's the question?
Sir, in Coulomb gauge, del dot A is equal to zero.
Mm-hmm. Divergence of A is zero, yes.
So then why we are choosing not equal to zero condition? Why we are choosing not equal to zero condition here?
No. What I'm saying is that given you start off like your boss gives you a vector potential and a scalar potential, okay? And tells you that, okay, go ahead and solve this system, fine. Now, when you take that vector potential, you take the curl of that vector potential, you get the magnetic field, right? That's the magnetic field that you observe in the lab, fine?
Yes. Yeah.
But when you take the divergence of the vector potential that your boss has given you, okay? All right. Then that divergence is not necessarily zero.
Okay.
Okay. So what do? You transform, you perform a gauge transformation.
Okay.
You get a new vector potential, A prime. Okay. Now, when you take the curl of A prime, the curl of A prime is equal to the curl of A because of Helmholtz theorem. Right? So they represent the same magnetic field.
Okay.
But now I can choose to impose this condition del dot A prime is equal to zero.
Okay.
So I choose to impose this condition. When I choose to impose this condition implies that my this gauge function chi has to satisfy this equation, Poisson's equation. Right? And this equation always has a solution. Okay? So the point is that no matter what A your boss gives you, right? You can always take the divergence of that A and put that on the right hand side of this equation. Okay? And then you can solve this equation to find chi. And then you can take the gradient of chi and add it to A.
Then it will give you.
And then you are left with a vector potential which satisfies the Coulomb restriction.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's a little bit of a long-winded, you know. So the point is that even if I don't start off with a vector potential which is not in the Coulomb gauge, I can always transform to a new gauge which does satisfy that condition. Okay. So when I do transform to that vector potential which satisfies that condition, then what happens? The Coulomb gauge tells me that this term becomes zero. This term vanishes. Okay. So to begin with, the vector potential I have may or may not satisfy the Coulomb gauge condition. Okay. If it satisfies the condition, great, I'm happy. But if it doesn't satisfy, I can always find a function chi which will give me another vector potential A prime, and that vector potential A prime I can put in here, and then I can do all of this with that A prime, and then del dot A prime will be zero. Right? But in doing so, I've not changed any of the physics anywhere. Right? Okay. So when I look at the kinetic term, coming back to this kinetic term, nice. Now I can't do this on a blackboard. In this kinetic term, what happens? The Coulomb gauge condition implies that this term goes to zero. And well, this term, okay, so again, let me be careful. This term is an operator. So this term acting on the state psi becomes divergence of A multiplying psi, and then this divergence goes to zero. And then there's a second term, A dot del psi. Okay. then this term and this term are the same. So I'm left with my final kinetic term, which looks like this. Right? And then I get a factor of 2, and then A dot gradient. This is my final kinetic term. So I'll just remove this factor of 2 here. Okay. And now what happens is that in these two terms, I can perform a little bit more of a manipulation. Okay, so let me show you how that works out. So now we will consider the case of a constant magnetic field, okay? Constant magnetic field. And so if I have a constant magnetic field, then this B I can always write as curl of A, right? But in particular, when B is a constant magnetic field, in that case, I can write down explicitly that A becomes minus R cross B, 1/2. Okay, so you can check this, that if you take the curl of this object, so I'll take the minus 1/2 outside. If you take the curl of R cross B, you will get B. Okay, so to do this again, you have this vector identity, curl of, right? You have this vector identity, right? That A cross B cross C can be written as A dot C times B, right? Minus A dot B times C. So you can do the same thing with this, and then one of the terms will be zero and the other term the other term will just give you B. Okay, so you will get one term will be A dot, so it will be del dot R divergence of R, and divergence of R will give you divergence of R is a constant, right? It's a sum constant, I think 1/3 or something. So this will just be a constant term and multiplying B, and that constant term will, I think divergence of R will give you minus two will cancel out this term. You'll just left with the other term. Okay, so if I substitute this expression for A, okay, I take this expression for A and now I substitute it here. All right, so what happens? I have A dot the gradient. Okay, and what does that become? That becomes B by 2 cross R. I've switched the 2, removed the minus sign. Okay, B by 2 dot R dot gradient. Okay, and now what is this? This is A dot B. This is like, if you think in terms of vectors, it's A cross B dot C, right? and then you can apply the cyclic permutation. So if you apply cyclic permutation, what do you get? A cross B dot C is equal to B cross C dot A is equal to C cross A dot B. Right? So in this case also you can apply that permutation because B is a constant field, and you can write this as R cross delta dot B like this. Okay. And with a factor of 1/2. So if I look at this term, write this properly. This is del. This term becomes I H bar Q by 2MC R cross del, right, dotted with B. Okay. And B is a constant vector field, so I can write it either as this dot B or B dot this. It doesn't matter, because since B is a constant, gradient acting on the constant will just give me zero. So now in this expression, let me put a minus sign here and write it like this. R, and then I take the H bar with the minus sign inside the brackets, and then I write it as R cross minus H bar del dot P. Right? Now what is this quantity, I H bar del minus?
It's
the momentum operator. And what is R cross P? Angular momentum. So what is this quantity, R cross P? Angular momentum operator. Right? And so this term becomes equal to minus Q by 2MC. L, so I'll write the B earlier, B dot L. Right? What does L tell us? It gives us the angular momentum of the particle in its orbit, let's say, if you're talking about a particle in a hydrogen atom. Right? So this couples the external magnetic field to the angular momentum of the particle, right? Which makes sense, because if you have a particle which is moving, which has some angular momentum, whether it's intrinsic or extrinsic, doesn't matter. If you have a charged particle with some angular momentum, then you can think then that object will have its own magnetic dipole moment, right? Whether you have an electron or any charged particle moving in a circle, right? So that's a current flowing in a circle. When you have a current flowing in a circle, there is a magnetic field through the circle. So there is a magnetic dipole moment. Or when you have a particle with spin, you imagine a small sphere with some charge and that is rotating. So again, a rotating sphere with charge will have a magnetic field and a corresponding dipole moment. So when you put that magnetic dipole moment in an external magnetic field, right, the external magnetic field will exert a torque on that magnetic dipole moment, right? And that torque will correspond to a potential energy which is given by B dot the magnetic dipole moment. Right? The same way that if I put an electric dipole moment, let's say D, vector D, in an electric field, then the potential energy is minus E dot D. Right? So in this case, this is my expression for this term. And so this term is known as the paramagnetic term. And the other term, which is the other term, the one with the A square, this term this is called the diamagnetic term. Okay, and it is the paramagnetic term which is responsible for the Zeeman effect, which is the splitting of the spectral lines of hydrogen in the presence of a electromagnetic field. Right? So this is the term which gives us the Zeeman effect. So you have all these different effects, right? Zeeman effect, Stark effect, this effect, that effect. Zeeman effect says that if you put a hydrogen atom or any other atom in an external magnetic field, the spectra of that atom will develop a degeneracy. Right? So where does that degeneracy come from? It comes from due to this term. So I'll send you some notes on this also, which I have also been following to help you, you know, understand whatever is going on. And I guess our class has gone on long enough, so I'll stop here. Are there any questions?
No.
Is my screen not updating?
Well, it's up to Q by 2MC. That equation.
Oh, okay. One second. Let me. Okay. It seems my. I lost my connection to Zoom, so I'll share that screen once again, okay, so that you can see what's going on, and I will also export this as PDF and share it with you all. So I presume that Divya is sharing all these links and PDF files with you guys, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So this is what I have. Okay. Yeah, Divya, you were saying something?
No.
No? Okay. So, any questions?
No, not today.
Okay. So, this is all has been a nice learning experience. So, anyway, first I'll stop the recording because we're done with the...